We hope you enjoyed the show. Come back and see us next year and enjoy William Shakespeare's King Lear.
Makes breath poor and speech unable. Beyond all manner of so much, I love you.
What shall Cordelia do? Love and be silent.
Of all these vows, taken from this line to this, we make thee lady. The thine and Albany's issue be this perpetual. But says our second daughter, our dearest regent, wife the cordial, speak.
Sir, I am made of the selfsame metal my sister is, and prize me at her worth. In my true heart I find she names my very deed of love, only that she comes too short. That I profess myself an enemy to all other joys, and find that I am alone felicitate in your dear highness's love.
And then poor Cordelia, and yet not so, since I'm sure my love's more richer than my tongue.
To thee thine hereditary ever remain this, ample third of our fair kingdom, no less in space for liberty and pleasure than that conferred on God. But now, our joy, although the last not least, what can you say to draw a third more opulent than your sisters? Speak.
Nothing, my lord.
Nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing will come of nothing. Speak again.
Unhappy that I am, I cannot heave my heart into my mouth. I love your majesty according to my bond, no more nor less.
Now, Cordelia, mend your speech a little, lest it may mar your fortunes.
Good my lord, you have begot me, bred me, loved me. I return those duties back as our right fit. Obey you, love you, and most honor you. Why have my sisters husbands if they say they love you all? Happily, when I wed, that lord whose hand must take my plight shall carry half my love with him, half my care and duty. Sure, I shall never marry like my sisters to love my father all.
But close thy heart with this.
Ah, good, my lord.
So young and so untender.
So young, my lord, and true.
Let be so. Thy truth, then, be thy dower. For by the sacred greatness of the sun, I hear this claim all my parental care, propinquity, and property of blood, and as a stranger to thy heart and me, hold thee from this forever, my sometime daughter.
Good my liege!
Peace, Kent! A flat between that dragon and his wrath. I love her most. Not to set my rest on her kind person, hence and avoid my sight. Draw me my grave, my peace, and here I give her father's heart from her. Alfred, all Burgundy, Cornwall and Albany, with my two drunken scouts, digest this bird. Let pride, which she goes blameless, marry her. I do invest you jointly with my power of preeminence and all the large effects of your majesty. Ourselves, by monthly vows, with reservation of 100 knights, by you to be sustained. Now I have both made with you by good terms. Only we still retain the name and all the additions to it. The sway, revenue, and execution of rest. Beloved sons, we yours. For which do you burn with four-head partridges?
One of the year, whom I have ever honored as my king, loved as my father, as my master followed, preserve thy state, and in thy best considerations, check this hideous rashness. My youngest daughter does not love thee least.
Stand on thy life no more.
My life I never held but as a pawn to wage against thine enemies, nor fear to lose it. Thy safety being the motive.
Out of my sight.
See better, Lear, that I might still remain the true blank of thine eye.
Oh, that's the best way.
Yes,
hear me, Rickwitz. O thine allegiance, hear me. Since thou hast sought to make us break our vow, which we durst never yet, take thy reward. 5 days we do allot thee your permission. And on the sixth, to turn thy hated back upon our kingdom. If on the tenth they follow, thy banished tongue be found in our dominions, the moment is thy death. Away! By Jupiter, that shall not be revoked.
Fare thee well, King. The gods to their dear shelter take thee, maid, and justly thinkest, as most rightly said, May your large speeches, your deeds prove that good effects may spring from words of love. Thus, Canto Princes, leads you all in you. He'll shape his old course in a country new. Here's France and Burgundy, my noble lord.
My lord of Burgundy, I first address all you who with this king and thriving for our lord's love. What in the least will you require in present hour with her, or cease your person love?
Most royal majesty, I crave no more than what your highness offered, nor will you tender less.
My noble Burgundy, when she was dear to us, he did hold her so. But now her price is fallen. So there she stands, with our displeasure feast and nothing more. She's there, and she is yours.
I know no answer.
Will you, with those infirmities she owes, unfriended, new adopted to our hate, dowered with our curse, and strangered with our oath, take her or leave her?
Pardon me, royal sir. Election makes not upon such conditions.
Then leave her. For by the power that made me, I tell you all her will. For you, great king, I would not from your love make such a stray to match you where I hate, never beseech you to avert your liking a more worthy way than on a wretch whom in nature is ashamed almost to acknowledge hers.
This is most strange, that she, that but even now is your best object, argument of your praise, ball of your age, should in this trice of time commit a thing so monstrous as to dismantle so many folds of favor.
I yet beseech your majesty, if for I want that glib and oily art to speak in purpose not, since what I will intend I'll do it before I speak, that you make known it is no vicious blot, murder or foulness, no unchaste action or dishonored step that hath deprived me of your grace and favor, but even for want of that for which I am richer, a still soliciting eye in such a tongue as I am glad I have not, though to not have it, hath lost me in your liking.
Better thou hast not been born, than not to please me better.
Is it but this, a tardiness in nature, which often leaves the history unspoke that it intends to do? My lord of Burgundy, what say you to the lady? Will you have her? She is herself a dowry.
Royal heir, give but that portion which yourself proposed, and here I take Cordelia by the hand, Duchess of Burgundy.
Nothing I have sworn, I have firm.
I am sorry, then. You have so lost a father, you must lose a husband.
Peace be with Burgundy. Since that respects a fortune are his love, I shall not be his wife.
Fairest Cordelia,
most choice forsaken, most love despised, thee and thy virtues here I seize upon. Be it lawful I take up what's cast away. Thy dowerless daughter, king, though by my chance, is queen of us, of ours, and of our fair friends.
Our Esther, friends, let her be thine, for we have no such daughter, nor shall we ever see that face of hers again. Therefore we go on without our grace, our love, our medicine. Come, noble Burgundy.
Bid farewell to your sisters.
The jewels of our father. With watched eyes, Cordelia leaves you. I know you, what you are. Love well our father. To your professed bosoms I commit him. But yet, alas, stood I within his grace, I would prefer him to a better place. So, farewell to you both.
Prescribe not us our duties.
Let your study be to content your lord, who hath received you at fortune's arms. You have obedience scanted, and well are worth the want you have wanted.
Time shall unfold what plated cunning hides. Well may you prosper.
Sister, it is not a little I have to say, but most nearly appertains to us both. I think our father will hence tonight.
Most definitely, and with you, and next month with us.
You see how full of changes his age is. The observation we have made of it hath not been little. He always loved our sister most, and with what poor judgment he hath now cast her off.
'Tis the uncertainty of his age, infirmary of his age, and such inconstant starts we like to have from him as this, kin
must do something. And in the heat.
Found nature! Art my goddess! To thy law my services are bound. Wherefore should I stand in the plague of custom and permit the curiosity of nations to deprive me, for I am some 12 or 14 moonshines like a brother? Why, bastard? Wherefore, base? When my dimensions are as well compact, my mind is generous and shape as true as honest madam's issue, why brand they us with base? With baseness, bastardy, base. Base? Who in the lusty stealth of nature takes more composition and fierce quality than doth with an adult, stale, tired man go to the creating an entire tribe of fox, got twixt asleep and wake? Well, legitimate Edgar, I must have your land. Our father's love is to the bastard, Edmund, as to the legitimate. Fine word, legitimate. Well, my legitimate. If this letter speak, and my invention thrive, Edmund the base shall top the legitimate. I grow. I prosper. Now, gods, stand up for bastards!
Kent banished thus, and France in color parted, and the kingdom tonight subscribed his power. Edmund, how now, what news?
So please, your lordship, none.
What paper were you reading?
Nothing, my lord.
No? What needed then that terrible dispatch of it into your pocket? The quality of nothing hath not such need died itself.
Let's see. I beseech you, sir, pardon me. It is a letter from my brother I have not all or read, but forasmuch as I have perused, I find it not fit for your or looking.
Give me the letter, sir. This policy and reverence of age keeps our fortunes from us till our oldness cannot relish them. Come to me that of this I may speak more. If our father would sleep till I waked him, should enjoy half his revenue forever and live the beloved of your brother Edgar. Huh. Conspiracy. Sleep till I waked him. You should enjoy half his revenue. My son Edgar, had he a hand to write this, a heart and brain to breed it in? Whence came this to you? Who brought it?
It was not brought me, my lord. There's the cunning of it. I found it thrown in the case of my closet.
You know the character to be your brother's?
It is his hand, my lord, but I pray that his heart is not in the contents.
He cannot be such a monster to his father who so tenderly and entirely loves him.
Nor is not sure. If your honor judging me, I will place you where you'll hear us confirm this, and by an auricular assurance have your satisfaction with no further delay than this very evening.
Heaven and earth! These late eclipses in the sun and moon portend no good to us. Machinations, hollowness, treachery, and all ruinous disorders follow us disquietly to our graves. Find out this villain, Edmund. It shall lose thee nothing. Do it carefully.
This is the excellent foppery of the world. That when we are sick in fortunes, often the serpent of our own behaviors, we make guilty of our disasters the sun, the moon, and the stars, as if we were villains by necessity.
I would have been what I am had the maidenliest star in the firmament twinkled on my bastardizing. Now, Edgar,
and petty comes like the catastrophe of the old comedy.
How about, Brother Edmund? What serious contemplation are you in?
Oh, I'm just thinking, brother. Of a prediction I read this other day, what should follow these eclipses?
Do you busy yourself about that?
I promise you, the effects you write of succeed unhappily.
How long have you been a sectary astronomical?
When saw you my father last?
Why did I go by?
Parted you in good terms. Found you no displeasure in him by word or countenance.
None at all.
Be thinking you may have offended him, and in my entreaty, forbear his presence until some little time to qualify the heat of his displeasure, which at this instant so rageth in him that with the mischief of your person it would scarce be allayed.
Some villain hath done me wrong.
That's my dear brother.
I pray. Here's my key.
Wait.
a credulous father, and a brother noble, whose nature is so far from doing arms that he suspects none, and on whose foolish honesty my practice is right easy. I see the business. Let me, if not by birth, if lands by wit, all with me's meat that I can fashion fit.
Did my father strike my gentleman for chiding of his fool?
Yes, madam.
By day and night, he wrongs me. Every hour he flashes into one gross crime or other that sets us all at odds. I'll not endure it. His nights were riotous, and himself upbraids us with every trifle. When he returns from hunting, I'll not speak with him. Say I'm sick.
He's coming, madam. I hear him.
Put on what weary negligence you please. If he dislike it, let him to our sister, whose mind and mine I know in that old one. Idle. Old man! That would still try to manage those authorities that he hath given away. Now, by my life, old fools are made babes again. Remember what I tell you.
Well, madam.
I'll write straight to my sister to hold my very course. Prepare for dinner.
If but my good intent may carry through itself to that fool issue from which I raised my likeness, thou banished Kent, if thou canst serve where thou dost stand condemned, so may it come thy master may find thee full of labor.
Let me not stay a jot for dinner. Go, get it ready. Now, what is that?
A man, sir.
What can sound the best, what good sound without?
I do profess to be no less than I seem. To serve him truly that will put me in trust, to love him that is honest, to converse with him who is wise and says little, to fear judgment, to fight what I cannot choose, and to eat no fish.
What art thou?
A very honest-hearted fellow, sir, and as poor as the king.
Thou be as poor for a subject as he is for a king. Thou art poor enough. What wouldst thou?
Service?
Who wouldst thou serve?
No.
You stand on me, fellow.
No, sir, but you have that in your countenance, which I would fain call master.
Oh, what's that?
Authority.
What services canst thou do?
I can keep an honest counsel. I can ride, run. I can mar a curious tale in telling it, and deliver a plain message bluntly. That which ordinary men are fit for, I am qualified in. And the best of me is diligence.
How old art thou?
I have years on my back. 48.
Follow me. Thou shalt serve me if I like thee no worse after dinner. I'll not part from thee yet.
Where's my name?
My fool. Don't you go hither, my fool. You, Sarah, where's my daughter?
Don't please you.
Oh. What says the fellow there? Call the clerk back. Where's my fool?
I think the world's asleep. Now, where's that mongrel?
My lord, he said your daughter is not well.
Why came the slave not back to me when I called him?
He answered me in the roundest manner. He would not.
He would not?
My lord, I know not what the matter is, but to my judgment, your highness is not entertained with that ceremonious affection as you were wont. There's a great abatement of kindness in him as well in the general dependence as in the duke himself and also your daughter.
Sayest thou so?
I beseech your pardon, sir, if I be mistaken. But my duty cannot be silent when I think your highness wrong.
Thou but misrememberest me of thine own conception. I have received a most faint neglect of late. But where's my fool? I've not seen him these 2 days.
Since my lady's going into France, sir, the ball must find a way.
No more of that. I've noted it well. Go you. Tell my daughter I would speak with her. Go you, go hither, my fool. You! You, sir! Come you hither, sir! Who am I, sir?
My lady's father.
My lady's father? My lord's name, you whoreson dog. Oh, you slave, you cur. get out of the
sir, rise away. I'll teach these
friends. Now my friend, may I thank you for the honor of my service.
Arrive more than thou goest, and learn more than thou trowest.
Leave thy brink and thy moor, and leave the door, and thou shalt the more than she can.
This is nothing, fool! This is like the breath of an unclean lawyer. You give me nothing for it.
You can make no use of nothing, country.
Why, no boy, nothing can be paid out of nothing.
Prithee, tell him so much the rest of his land comes to, he will not prove me a fool.
A bitter fool! Here, nature, here, dear goddess, here. been thy purpose, if thou didst intend to make this creature fruitful. Into her womb convey sterility, dry up in her the organs of increase, and from her derelict body never spring a babe to honor her. If she must deem, create her child of speed, that it may live a more disnatured torment to her. Turn all her mother's aids and benefits to laughter and contempt, that she may feel how sharper than a serpent's tooth it is to have a thankless child. Away, away!
How dogs be a dog, whereof comes this?
Never afflict yourself to know the cause, but let his disposition have that scope and dotage gives it.
Lord, if I best be of my father's had a cut within a fortnight.
What's the matter, sir?
I'll tell thee. Life and death! I was saying thou hast power to shake my manhood thus. These hot tears that break from me before should make thee worth them. Bless that rose upon thee! Yes, I have left a daughter who I am sure is kind and comfortable. Thou shalt find that I'll resume the shape that thou dost think I have cast off forever. Thou shalt, I warrant thee.
Do you mark that, my lord? What, Oswald? Halt!
I cannot be so partial, Donald, to the great love I
come, say. Sir, no more! This man hath had good counsel. He may have guarded his dotage with their powers and hold our lives in mercy. Oswald, I say!
Well, you may fear too far.
Safer than trust too far. How now, Oswald? What? Have you written that letter to my sister?
Yes, madam.
Inform her full of my fears. Take you some company and away to horse. Get you gone and hasten her return.
How far your eyes may pierce, I cannot tell. Striving to better, oft we mar what's well.
Go you before the Gloucester with these letters. Acquaint my daughter no further with anything you know that comes of her demand out of the letter. Your diligence be not speedy, I'll be there before you.
Oh, I'll not sleep, my lord, till I have delivered your letter.
You don't see the other doesn't be using kindly, Will. She's as like this as a crab's like an apple.
If I can tell what I can
tell. What canst thou tell, boy?
If thou art my food, then I'll have thee beaten for being old before thy time.
How is that?
Thou shouldst not have been old till thou hadst been wise.
Let me not be mad, sweet heaven. It be in temper, I will not leave my hand.
The Duke be here tonight. The better. Pest? This weaves itself perforce into my business. Brother, over! My father watches, sir. Fly this place. Intelligence is given where you are hid. I hear my father coming. Pardon me. In cunning, I must draw my sword upon you. Well, draw, so you can defend yourself.
That put you well.
What ho, here!
My brother!
Torches! Torches!
Farewell.
Some blood drawn on me with Baguette's opinion. Of my more fierce endeavors, I have seen drunkards do more than this in sport. Father! Father, stop! Stop! No help!
Now, Edmund, where's the villain?
Stood he here in the dark, his sharp sword out, mumbling of wicked charms!
But where is he?
Look, sir, I bleed!
Where is the villain, Edmund?
This way! This way!
Go after! By no means what?
That he can persuade me to the murder of your lordship.
Let him fly far. Not in this land shall he remain uncaught. The noble Duke of Cornwall comes tonight, By his authority, I will proclaim it that he which finds him shall deserve our thanks. All ports I'll bar, the villain shall not escape. Hark, the Duke's trumpets. I know not why he comes.
Hello, my little friend. Since I came hither, I have heard strange news.
If it be true, all vengeance comes too short. How doth, my lord?
Oh, madam, my heart is cracked. It's cracked.
What? Thy father's godson seek your life. He whom my father named be your Edgar.
Oh, lady, lady, shame would have it in.
Was he not companion with righteous knights that tend upon my father?
I know not, madam. Tis too bad, too bad.
Yes, madam. He was of thy consort.
No marvel, then. I have this present evening from my sister been well informed of them. With such cautions that they come to sojourn at my house, I'll not be there.
Edward, I hear that you have shown your father a childlike office.
Was my duty, sir.
Natures of such deep trust we shall much need. You be first, Caesar.
I shall serve you, sir. Truly, however else. For him we thank your grace.
You know not how we came to visit you.
Thus out of season, fretting dark-eyed night, occasions noble Gloucester of some poise wherein we must have use of your advice. My father hath writ, and sister too, of differences I saw least fit to answer from my house. Good noble friend, bestow your needful counsel unto our business.
I serve you, madam. Your graces are right welcome. Mire.
Prithee, if thou lovest me, tell me.
I love thee not.
Why then I care not for thee?
If I had thee in lips very pinfold, I would make thee care for me.
Why dost thou use me thus? I know thee not.
Fellow, thee.
What dost thou know me for?
A knave, a rascal, a base, proud, shallow, beggarly, filthy knave. One whom I would read into a clamorous whining if thou deniest the least syllable of thy addition. What a monstrous fellow thou art to will one that is neither known to thee nor knows thee. What a brazen face all in our vow to deny thou knowest me. Is it not 2 days ago since I tripped up thy heels and beat thee before the king? Draw your load away, I have nothing to do with thee.
Draw your rascal, you come with thy back against the king.
Help, oh, murder!
Upon your lives, he dies that strikes again. What is the matter?
Messengers from our sister and our king.
What is your difference?
I am scarce in breath, my lord.
No marvel you have so bestirred your valor, you cowardly rascal.
Speak yet, how grew your quarrel?
This ancient ruffian, sir, whose life I spared in suit of his rapier.
Thou horseman's head! Thou unnecessary letter! Spear my great beard! You wagtail!
Peace, sir! You beastly knave! Know you no reverence? Where am I?
That such a slave as this should wear a sword who wears no honesty!
Why art thou mad, old fellow?
How fell you out? Say that!
His countenance liked me not.
No more perchance does mine, nor his, nor hers.
Sir, 'tis my occupation to be plain. I have seen better faces in my time than stand on any shoulders I see before me at this instant.
Fetch forth the stocks, you stubborn ancient knave. You reverend brat will teach you.
Call not your stocks for me. I serve the king, on whose employments I was sent to you. You shall give you small respect to the grace and person of my master, stocking his messenger.
Fetch forth the stocks! If I have life and honor, where shall he sit till noon?
Till noon? Till night, and all the night through. Come, the stocks!
Let me beseech your grace not to do so. The king must take it ill that he's so slightly valued in his messenger.
I'll answer that.
My sister would have it much more worse to have her messenger abused and assaulted for following in her affairs. Put his arms. Come, let's away.
I am sorry for you, friend. 'Tis the Duke's pleasure, whose disposition the whole world well knows. I'll entreat for thee.
Pray do not, sir. I have watched and traveled hard some
Time I shall sleep away. The rest I'll whistle. The deuce to blame in this, 'twill be ill taken. Fortune, good night. Smile once more. Turn thy wheel.
I heard myself proclaimed, and by the happy hollow of a tree escaped the hunt. No port is free. No place does not attend my taking. Whilst I may escape, I will preserve myself, and to be thought to take the basest and most poorest shape that ever penury and contempt of man brought near to beast. My face I'll grime with filth. Blanket my loins, elf all my hair in knots, and with presented nakedness outface the winds and persecutions of the sky. The country gives me proof and precedent of bedlam beggars, who with roaring voices, sometime with lunatic bands, sometime with prayers, enforce their charity. Poor Turlingon. Poor Tom. Poor Turlingon. Poor Tom. That's something yet. Edgar, I nothing am.
It is strange that they should so depart from home and not send back my messenger.
As I learned the night before, there was no purpose in them of this room.
Hail to thee, noble master! But make a sound this shame thy pastime.
No, my lord!
What's he that hath thy place so much mistook to send thee here?
It is both he and she, your son and daughter.
No.
Yes.
No, I say.
I say yea.
No, they would not.
Yes, they have.
They would not, they durst not, they could not do it.
Witches now that gone of wild geese fly that way.
Follow me not, stay here.
How come, king, chances with so small a train?
And now we're setting the stops for that question, thou hadst well deserved it.
Why, fool?
Well, said he to school. All that follow their noses are led by their eyes but blind men. And there's not a nose among 40 that can smell him that's stinking. Like go my home when the great wheel runs down the hill as to break thy neck in following it. The great one goes up the hill, let him draw thee after. When a wise man gives thee better counsel, give thee mine again. I should have none but names following from the fool who gets it.
Deny to speak with me. They are sick, they are weary. They have traveled all the night.
My dear lord, you know the fiery quality of the duke, how unremovable and fixed he is in his own court.
Why, Gloucester, fetch me a better answer. I'd speak with the Duke of Cornwall.
Here.
Right.
Well, my good lord, I have informed them so.
Informed them? Dost thou understand me, man? The king would speak with Cornwall.
Yeah.
The dear father would with his daughter speak with
the master's service.
Death on my stake, wherefore should he be this? Go tell the Duke and his wife I'd speak with them now, presently. Bid them come forth and hear me, or at their chamber door I'll beat the drum.
Yeah. Well, I would have all well betwixt you.
Now my rising heart. Now. Bring them all to you both.
Hail to your grace.
I'm glad to see your highness.
Bring it, I think you are. Oh, are you free? Some other time for that. My sister's not. O'Regan, she has tied sharp tooth on kindness like a vulture here. Oh, I can scarce speak to thee. Thou not believe with how depraved her quality, O'Regan.
I pray you, sir, have patience. I have hope. You scarce know how to value her deserves than she to stand her duty.
How's that?
Well, I cannot think in the least my sister would fail her obligation. If, sir, perchance she restrained the riots of your knights, 'tis on such ground and to such wholesome end as clears her from all blame.
My curses on her!
Sir, you are old, and should be ruled and led by some state that discerns your state better than you yourself. Therefore, I pray you, sir, that you do make return to my sister. Say you have wronged her.
Ask her forgiveness? Do you but mark how this becomes the state? Dear daughter, I confess I am old. Age is unnecessary. On my knees, I beg you vouchsafe me raiment, bed, and food.
No more of these, sir. These are dirty tricks. Return you to my sister.
Never again. She has abated me half my train, looked back upon me, struck me with her tongue, most serpent-like upon the very heart. All the storm vengeances of heaven fall on her and make no top.
Yes, sir.
Oh, blessed gods, and so will you wish on me when the rash mood is on.
No, Nina. Thou shalt never have my first. Until the gifted nature will not give thee over to harshness. Her eyes are fierce. Comfort cannot hurt. 'Tis not in thee to grudge my pleasures, cut off my trade. Thou better knowest the offices of nature, dues of gratitude. Thy half of the kingdom thou hast not forgot, wherein I thee endowed.
Good sir, to the purpose.
I'll pay my man in the stocks. I have good hope we get thou dost not know it. I have it! Come see, art thou not ashamed to look upon this man? Will you take her by the hand?
Why not by the hand, my lord? How have I offended? All's not offense that indiscretion and dotage term so.
Besides, you are too tough. Will you yet hold? Out came my man in the stock. I set him there, sir.
You, did you?
I pray you, sir. Being weak, seem so. If till the month of your expiration, return you and sojourn with my sister, dismissing half your men. Come then to me.
Return to her and 50 men dismissed? No, brother, I abjure all rules, and choose to wage against the enemy in the air, to be a comrade with a wolf, but now...
At your choice, sir.
Daughter, do not make me mad. I'll no more trouble thee, my child. Farewell. We'll no more meet, no more see one another. Yet, thou art my flesh, my blood, my water. Or rather, a disease that's in my flesh that I must needs call mine. Boiler, plague sore, an embossed carbuncle in my corrupted blood. But I'll not try. Bend when thou canst. Be better at thy leisure. I can be patient. I can stay with Regan. I and my 100 knights.
Not altogether so, sir. I am not looked for you, nor am provided for your fit welcome. I pray you, give ear to my sister. She knows what she does.
Is this well spoken?
I dare about it. What? 50 followers? What need you of so many, yea, or more? How can two, how can so many, under one roof, under two commands hold amity? 'Tis hard, almost impossible.
Why might not you, my lord, receive attendance from those that she calls servants? Boy, they're mine.
Why not, my lord? If you return to me, I pray you bring a better knight, 25. No more will I give place or notice.
I gave you all.
And in good time you gave it.
I made you guard my guardians, my depositories, but kept the reservation to be followed by such a number. Come to you with but 25. Bring it, said himself.
And speak it again. No more with me.
For those wicked creatures are well favored. When others are more wicked, not be the worst, stands in some rank of praise. I'll go with thee. I 50 to double 25, and thou art twice her own.
Hear me, my lord. What need you 25? 10 or 5. To follow in a house where twice as many have command to tend you.
What need?
Oh, reason not the need! Our basest beggars are in the poorest things superfluous. Allow not nature more than nature needs. Man's life is cheapest beast. Thou art a lame, if only to the war for gorgeous. Why, nature needs not what thou gorgeous wearest, which scarce keeps thee warm. But what true need, You heavens, give me that patience! Patience I need! You see me here, you gods, a poor old man as full of grief as age, wretched in both. If it be you that stir these daughters' hearts against their father, fool me not so much to bear tailing. Fill me with noble anger. No! You unnatural hags! I'll have such revenges on you both that all the world shall. I shall do such things, what they are yet I don't know, but they shall be the terrors of the earth. You think, oh, no, I'll not weep. I have no cause of weeping, but this heart shall break into 100,000 claws, or ere I weep, oh, I shall go mad.
Let us withdraw, it will be a storm.
House is small, the old men of his people cannot be well bestowed.
Tis his own blame hath put himself from rest, and must needs taste his folly.
For his particular, I will receive him gladly, but not one follower.
So am I purposed.
The king is in high rage.
Whither is he going?
He calls the horse, but will I know not whither.
It's best to give him way, he leads himself.
My lord, entreat him by no means to stay.
Alack, the night comes on, and the bleak winds do sorely ruffle. For many miles about, there's scarce a bush.
Oh, sir, to willful men the injuries they themselves procure must be their schoolmasters. Shut up your doors.
Shut up your doors, my lord. 'Tis a wild night, and my reading counsels well. Out of the storm.
Say you nothing.
There is a division betwixt the dukes, and a worse matter than that. I have received a letter this night. These injuries the king now bears will be revenged. There is a power already footed. We must incline to the king. Go you, and maintain talk with the duke. If he asks for me, I am ill and gone to bed. Though I die for it, as no less has threatened me, the king, my old master, must be relieved. There is some strange thing toward, Edmund. Pray you.
This shall the duke instantly know, and of that letter too. That which my father loses, no less than all, the younger rises when the old doth fall.
Here is the place, my lord, with my lord Aegon. The tyranny of the open night is too rough for nature to endure.
Let me alone.
Could my lord Aegon here?
Will break my heart.
I'd rather break my bone. Could my lord Aegon?
Prithee, get me in, seek thine own ease. Hey, boy, go first, thou house of poverty, then I get me in. I'll pray, then I'll sleep. Poor, naked wretches, wherever you are, the cry for the felony of this bitter storm. How shall your house look at that unkept size? Defend you from season such a thing. Now I've taken too little care of this. Take physic, pump! Expose thyself to feel what wretches feel. Show the heavens more just.
Thank you.
let my revenger in apart this house!
Now, my lord, this is the letter he spoke of, which approves him an intelligent party to the advantages of France. Heavens, if this treason were not, or not I the protector.
Go with me to the Duchess.
But if the matter of this paper be certain, you have mighty business in hand.
True or false, that may be Earl of Gloucester. Seek out where thy father is, that he may be ready to have apprehension. I will lay trust upon thee, and thou shalt find a dearer father in my love.
Here is better than the open air. Take it thankfully. I will piece out the comfort with what addition I can. I will not be long from you.
All the power of his wits have given way to his impatience. May God reward your kindness.
Come sit now here, most learned justice. I will array them straight.
How do you, sir? Will you lie down and rest?
I'll see their trial first. Bring in the evidence. Thou roving man of justice, take thy place. And thou, his rook fellow in equity, bench by his side.
Let us deal justly.
Arraign her first. Goneril!
Come hither, mistress. Is your name Goneril?
I deny it. I take my oath before the sound of assembly. She hit the poor king, her father. Here's another whose warped looks proclaim what store her heart is made on.
Stop with it! Arms, sword, fire! Confusion! False justice, why hast thou let her escape?
Bless thy five wits!
Oh, pity! Sir, where have we set patience now that thou so often boasted to retain?
My tears begin to take his part so much they'll mar my counterfeiting.
Poor Tom!
Oh, how do you, sir? Will you lie here and rest a while?
Make no noise. All good. So, we'll go to supper in the morning.
Come hither, friend. Where is the king, my master?
Here, sir, but trouble not. His wits are gone.
Good friend, I prithee, take him in thy arms. I have overheard a plot of death upon him. There is a litter ready. Payment and drive towards Dover, friend, where thou shalt receive both welcome and protection. Take up thy master. If thou shouldst dally half an hour, his life with thine, and all who offer to defend it stand in assured loss. Take up, and follow me.
Come, help me, thy master. Thou must not stay behind.
Come away.
When we our betters see bearing our woes, we scarcely think our miseries our foes. How light and portable my pain seems now, when that which makes me bend makes the king bow. Tom away. What will hap for tonight, save scape the king? Lurk.
Pray do me no foul play, friends.
Hard, O filthy traitor. traitor.
Ungrateful lady as you are, I am none. I am your host. What will you do?
Come, sir. What letters had you late from France?
Be simple, answerer, for we know the truth.
And what confederacy have you with the traitor's late quartered in the kingdom?
To whose hands have you sent the lunatic king? Speak.
I have a letter guessingly sent down, which came from one that's of a neutral heart and not from one opposed.
Cunning.
And false.
Where hast thou sent the king?
To Dover.
Wherefore to Dover? Was thou not charged at Paris?
Wherefore to Dover? Let him first answer that.
Wherefore to Dover, sir?
Because I would not see thy cruel nails pluck out his poor old eyes. But I shall see the winged vengeance overtake such children.
See it shalt thou never. Those, hold the chair. On these eyes of thine I'll set my foot.
He that will live till he be old, give me some help. O cruel, O you gods!
If you see vengeance...
Hold your head, my lord. I have served you ever since I was a child. A better service have I never done you now than made you whole.
How now, you dog?
My villain!
Nay then, come on and take the chance, baby.
So glad you're here tonight. I always come out now at intermission these days because so much of our crowd these days comes up a little late. And you know, at the beginning of the show, we talked about the importance of your donations. We passed some baskets around. Our basket takers don't always get close to everybody, and some people come up a little late and miss that opportunity. So we keep a donation box back at our front of house table. If you didn't get a chance to drop something in a basket earlier in the evening, if you could drop something in the box on your way out, it means the world to us. It's what helps us keep coming out here year after year and will help us come back next year for what will be our 27th season. Yeah. Thank you. As you can see, I was six when we started the company. And we do plan to be back out here next year, but we think we're going to do The Two Gentlemen of Verona and Romeo and Juliet. So help us out. Drop something in the box. This is our last night for this year. We're sad that it's over, but we're glad you're here. Come back next year. The band's going to do one more song and then right into Act Two of King Lear. Thank you, everybody, so much.
Welcome, thou unsubstantial air that I embrace. The wretch that thou hast blown into the worst owes nothing to thy blasts. But who comes here? My father, poorly led. World. World, lord.
Away, get thee away, good friend. Be gone. Thy comforts can do me no good at all. Me they may hurt.
Alack, sir, you cannot see your way.
I have no way, and therefore want no eyes. I stumbled when I saw, oh, dear son Edgar, the food of thy abused father's wrath. Might I but see thee again in my touch, I'd say I had eyes again.
Fellow, where goest?
Is it a beggar man? In the last night's storm I such a fellow saw, which made me think a man a worm. My son came then into my mind, and yet my mind was then scarce friends with him. I have heard more since. As flies to wanton boys are we to the gods. They kill us for their sport.
Bless thee, master.
Is that the naked fellow?
Aye, my lord.
Sirrah, naked fellow.
Or Tom's a cold.
I cannot delve it further. Come hither, fellow.
And yet I must.
Bless thy sweet eyes. They bleed. Knowest thou the way to Dover?
Both stile and gate, horseway and footpath.
There is a cliff whose high and bending head looks fearfully in the confided deep. Bring me but to the very brim of it, and I will repair the misery thou dost bear with something rich about me. From that place I shall no leading need.
Give me your hand, or Tom shall lead thee.
Mistress's command. Fare thee well, my most dear Gloucester. Now here's my lord.
Oh, Goneril, you are not worth the dust which the rude wind blows in your face.
No more, the text is foolish.
What have you done? Tigers, not daughters, what have you performed?
A father,
and a gracious aged man, most barbarous, most degenerate, have you maddened?
Milk! Livered man that bearest a cheek for blows and a head for wrongs. Where's thy drum? France spreads his banners in our noiseless land, while thou, a moral fool, sittest still and criest alack. Why does he so?
Thou shaven and self-covered thing, for shame. Monster, not thy creature. Grant my fitness to let these hands obey my blood, and they are enough to dislocate and tear thy flesh and bone.
Oh, marry your man!
What news?
Oh, my good lord, the Duke of Cornwall's dead. Was slain by a servant going to put out the other eye of Gloucester.
Gloucester's eye?
Oh, poor Gloucester.
This letter, madam, craves a speedy answer. It is from your sister.
One way I like this well, but being widow and my sister with her, my poor Gloucester. Another way, the news is not so tart. I'll read and answer.
Gloucester, I live to thank thee for the love thou showest the king, and to revenge thine eyes. Come hither, friend. Tell me what more thou knowest.
Secrets. Be aid and remediate in the good man's distress. Seek!
Seek for him, lest his ungoverned rage dissolve the life that wants the means to lead it.
News, madam, the British powers are marching hitherward.
'Tis known before. Our preparation stands in expectation of them. Oh, my dear father, it is thy business that I go about. No blown ambition doth our arms incite, but love, dear love, and our aged father's right. Soon may I hear and see him.
What are my brother's powers set forth?
Aye, madam.
Himself in person there?
Madam, with much ado, your sister's the better soldier.
And Lord Edmund spake not with your lord at home?
No, madam.
What should import my sister's letter to him?
I know not, lady.
Faith, he has posted hints on serious matters. 'Twas great ignorance, Gloucester's eyes being out to let him live. Where he arrives, he moves all hearts against us. Edmund, I think, is gone to descry the strength of the enemy.
I must needs after it, madam, with my letter.
Our troops set forth tomorrow. Stay with us. The ways are dangerous.
I may not, madam. My lady charged my duty in this business.
And why should she write to him? Might you transport her purposes by word? Let me unseal the letter.
Madam, I'd rather
not. I know your lady does not love her husband. Of that I am sure. But of her late being here, she gave most strange and speaking looks to Sir Edmund. I know that you are of her bosom.
I, madam.
Oh, I speak in understanding. You are. I know it. Therefore, give her this note. My lord is dead. Edmund and I have spoken more conveniency for my hand than for your ladies. You may gather more. Oh, and if you do find her, I pray you, give him this. When you disclose thus much to your lady, I pray you, have her call all her wisdom to her. Fare thee well. Ah, and if you do come upon that blind traitor, preferment falls on him that cuts him off.
Would I could meet him, madam, then I should show what party I do follow.
Fare thee well.
When shall we come to the top of that same hill?
You do climb it now. Look how we labor.
Methinks the ground is even.
Horrible steep. Hark! Do you hear the sea?
No, truly.
Why, then your other senses grow imperfect by your eyes' anguish.
So may it be indeed. Methinks thy voice is altered, and thou speakst in better phrase and matter than thou didst.
Why, then, thou art much deceived, and nothing might change but in my garments.
Methinks you're better spoken.
Come then this way, sir.
Here's the spot. Stand still.
How fearful! And dizzy 'tis to cast one's eyes so low. The fishermen that walk upon the beach appear like mice. And yon tall anchoring bark almost too small for sight. I'll look no more, lest my brain turn and the deficient side topple down headlong.
Set me where you stand.
Give me your hand. You are now within a foot of the extreme verge.
Let go my hand and go thou farther off. Bid me farewell, and let me hear thee going.
Farewell, good sir!
With all my heart!
Why do I trifle thus with his despair as done to cure it?
Oh, you mighty gods! This world I do renounce, and in thy sights shake patiently my great affliction off!
Ho, oh, sir! Friend! Hear you, sir? Speak! What are you, sir?
Away, and let me die!
Had thou been aught but gossamer feathers air, so many fathom down precipitating, thou shivered like an egg. And thou dost breathe? Yes, heavy substance. Pleads not, speak yet again.
But have I fallen or no?
Give me your hand. Up, so, how is it? You feel your legs? You stand? Upon the crown of the cliff, what thing was that which parted from you? As I stood here below, methought his eyes were two full moons. He had a thousand noses, horns, whelped, and waved like the enraged sea. It was some fiend. Therefore, thou happy father, think that the clearest gods, which make honors of men's impossibilities, have preserved thee. And who comes here?
cannot touch me, for Gordon, I am the king himself. There's your press money. Oh, look! A mouse! These toasted cheese. I'll pull it on a guy. See the word?
Sweet Marjorie.
Pat.
I know that voice.
Gunner with white hair. Oh, they flattered me like a dog.
And when the thunder had no peace in my bidding,
there I smoked them out.
They told me I was everything.
The lie.
I'm nothing, you poof. They stopped the king.
Oh, every inch a king. When I do stare, I see how the subject quakes. I pardon that man's life. What was I cause? Adultery? Thou shalt not die. Die for adultery. No, the wren goes twink. On the small gilded flag, a Fletcher in my sight. Let copulation thrive. My Gloucester bastard son was kinder to his father than my daughter's got between lawful sheets. There's the suffer's pit, burn, scalding, stench, consumption. That. But do it, luxury pell-mell. I lack soldiers.
Oh, let me kiss that hand.
Let me wipe first. It smells of mortality.
The ruined piece of nature. This great world shall so wear out to naught. Dost thou know me?
I remember thy eyes well enough. Just now squinty at me. Read. Now, this. The elegy. Mark, what the penning of it?
For all the letters, son, I could not see one.
No eyes in your head, nor no money in your purse, but you see how the world goes.
See it feelingly.
What a man! A man may see how the world goes with no eyes. Look with your ears. See how yon justice reels upon yon simple thief. Hark with thy ears. Change places handy dandy. Which is justice? Which is thief? Thou hast seen a farmer's dog bark at a beggar. Look. Reach. Run from the curb. There thou mayest behold the great image of authority. A dog's obey in office. Get thee glass eyes, and like a scurvy politician, she deceit them as thou dost not. Off with my boots now! Harder, harder, harder! Off with my boots, so!
Reason and madness.
If thou wilt weep my fortunes, paint my eyes. I know it well enough. My name is Gloucester. Must be patient. When we are born, we cry that we have come to this great stage of fools. We're a delicate stentor, the shoe and foot of a horse. I'll put it proof. And when I stole it upon his sons in law, then kill, 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 kill.
Here he is. Sir, your most dear daughter.
No rescue? What a prisoner. I need an unnatural fool of fortune. Let me have surgeons. I'm cut to the brains.
You shall have anything.
No seconds. All myself. I'll migrate. I'll be jovial. I am a king, my master, so you that.
You are a royal one, and we obey you.
And have life in it. Nay, you get it. You'll get it with running. Sa 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 sa!
You ever gentle gods, take my breath from me. Let not my worser spirit tempt me again to die before you please.
Pray well, father.
Now, good sir, what are you?
A most poor man, maintained to fortune's blows. Give me your hand. I'll lead you to some fighting.
A proclaimed prize, most happy.
That eyeless head of thine was first framed flesh to raise my fortunes. Thou old unhappy traitor, briefly thyself remember. Wherefore, bold peasant, darest thou support a public traitor? Hence.
Hey, come not near this old man.
Let go, slave, thou dyke!
Chill, pick your teeth!
Slave! Thou hast slain me! If ever thou wilt thrive, bury my body! And give these letters that thou findest about me to Edmund, Earl of Gloucester! Seek him out upon the British plain! Oh, untimely death!
What? Is he dead?
He's dead. Since you're here, Father, rest you. Let's see these pockets. The letters he speaks of may be my friends. Let our reciprocal vows be remembered. You have many opportunities to cut him off. There is nothing done. If he return the conqueror, then I am the prisoner. Bring me in to supply the place for your labor. Your wife? So I would say affectionate servant, Goneril. Indistinguished space of woman's will. A plot upon her virtuous husband's life. And the exchange, my brother. I must at once, with this ungracious paper, strike the side of the death practice duke.
Give me your hand! Far off methinks I hear the beaten drum. Come, Father, I'll bestow you with a friend.
Have some cause. They have not.
No cause. No cause.
Am I in France?
In your own kingdom, sir.
Be comforted, good madam. The great rage you see is killed in him. Desiring to go in, trouble him no further, no more settling.
Will it please your highness, walk?
You must bear with me. Pray you now forget that, forgive. I'm old and foolish.
An honored love.
But have you not found my brother's way to the forfended place?
That thought abuses you.
I am doubtful that you have been conjunct and bosomed with her, as far as we call hers.
No, by mine honor, madam.
I shall not endure her. Be not familiar with her, my lord.
Fear me not.
Our very loving sister will be met. Sir, this I hear. The king is come to Cordelia.
Combine together against the enemy, for these domestic and particular broils are not the question here.
Let's then determine on our proceedings.
I shall attend you presently at your tent.
I pray you, sister, go with us.
No.
I pray you, 'tis most convenient. Go with us.
Ho ho, I know the riddle. I will go.
Ere your grace had speech with men so poor, hear me one word.
Well, Lubitaine, you speak.
Before you fight the battle, open this letter. Wretched though I seem, I can produce a champion that'll prove what is avouched there.
Stay till I have read the letter.
I was forbidden. When time shall serve, let but the herald cry, and I'll appear again.
I fare thee well. I will o'erlook thy papers.
The enemy is in view.
Draw up your powers. But your haste is now urged on.
We will greet the tide.
To both of these sisters have I sworn my love, each jealous of the other. But which of them shall I take?
Both? One? Or neither? Neither can be enjoyed if both remain alive. To take the widow exasperates her sister Goneril, and hardly shall I carry out my side, her husband being alive. Now then, we'll use his countenance for the battle, which being done, let her who would be rid of him devise of his speedy taking off. As for the mercy which he intends to Lear and Cordelia, the battle done and they within our power, shall never see his pardon.
Come on!
You're not the first who, with best meaning, have incurred the worst. For thee, oppressed king, am I cast down. Myself could else out-frown false fortune's frown. Shall we not see these daughters and these sisters?
No! No, no, no. Come, let's away to prison, where we two alone will sing like birds in a cage. When you do ask me blessing, I'll kneel down and ask of thee forgiveness. So we'll live, pray, and sing, tell old tales, laugh at guilty butterflies, and hear poor rogues talk of court notes, and I'll talk to them too. Who loses, who wins, who's in, who's out. Take upon us the mystery of things, as if we were God's spies.
Take them away. Come hither, Captain. Take thou this note, go follow them to prison. If thou dost as this instructs thee, thou dost make thy way to noble fortunes. Tip-tip. Thy great employments will not bear question. Either say thou do it, or thrive by other means.
I'll do it, my lord.
Sir, you have the captives and were the officers of this day's strife. We do require them of you.
Sir, I thought it fit to send the old and miserable king to some retention and appointed guard.
Sir, by your patience, I hold you but a subject of this war, not as a brother.
Not as we list to grace him. He led our powers forth commission of my place and person, the which immediacy may well stand up and call itself your brother.
Not so hot. In his own grace he doth exalt himself more than in your addition.
By my rights, by me invested, he compares the best.
That were the most if he should husband you.
Lady, I am not well, else I would answer you with full-flowing stomach. General, take you these, my prisoners, soldiers, patrimony, dispose of them, of me. The walls are thine. Let the world witness here that I make thee my lord and master.
Mean you to enjoy him?
But that alone lies not in your goodwill.
Nor in thine, lord.
Half-blooded fellow, yes.
Let the drum strike and prove my title thine.
Stay yet. Edmund, I arrest thee on capital treason. And in thine attaint, this gilded serpent. For your claim, fair sister, I bar it in the interest of my wife. 'Tis she is subcontracted to this lord, and I, her husband, contradict your bans. If you will marry, make your loves to me. My lady is bespoke. Thou art armed, Gloucester. Let the trumpet sound. If none appear to prove upon thy head thy heinous manifest and many treasons, there's my pledge, I'll prove it on thy heart.
There's my exchange. What in the world he is that names me traitor? Villain like he lies. If any man of quality or degree within the list of the army shall maintain upon Edmund, Earl of Gloucester, that he's a manifold traitor, let him appear.
What's he? That speaks for Edmund, Earl of Gloucester.
Himself, what sayest thou to it?
Draw thy sword. Thou art a traitor, false to thy gods, thy brother, and thy father. And from the extremest upward of thy head to the descent and dust below thy foot, a most toad-spotted traitor. Say thou no? This sword, this arm, and my best spirits are fit to prove upon thy heart.
Back do I toss these treasons to thy head. Let's exchange charity. I'm no less in blood.
what then thou art Edmund? My name is Edgar, and thy father's son. The gods are just, and of our pleasant vices make instruments to plague us. That dark and vicious place where thee he got cost him his eyes. Thou hast spoken right. 'Tis true. The wheel has come full circle. I am here. Die!
Let sorrow split my heart if ever I can hate thee or thy father.
Worthy prince, I know it.
How have you known the miseries of your father?
By nursing them, my lord. Met I my father with his bleeding rings, their precious stones, new lost. Became his guide. Led him. Begged for him, saved him from despair, but never fault. Revealed myself to him until some half hour passed, but his flawed heart, alack, too weak, the conflict to support, twixt two extremes of passion, joy, and grief burst, smilingly.
This speech of yours has moved me. Help! Help! Oh, help!
What kind of help?
Speak
that! What means that bloody knife?
It came even from the heart of... She's dead.
Dead, speak, man.
Your lady, sir, your lady. And her sister, by her is poisoned. She hath...
Produce the bodies. Be they alive or dead.
I am come to bid my king and master aye good night.
Is he not here?
Seest thou this object, Kent?
Alack, why thus?
This judgment of the heavens that makes us tremble touches us not with pity. Speak, Edmund.
I was contracted for them both, all three, now marry in an instant. Yet, Edmund was beloved, won the other poison for my sake, and after she slew herself.
Even so, cover their faces.
I pay for life. Some good do I mean to do, despite of mine own nature. Quickly send, be brief in it, to the castle, for my rent is on the life of Lear and on Cordelia. Nay, send in time.
Yeah, right.
Haste thee for thy life. He hath commission from thy wife and me to hang Cordelia in the prison, and to lay the blame upon her own despair, that she forget herself.
Oh! Oh, you have been of stone. If I had your tongue tonight, I'd use them so that heaven's bolts should crack. He's gone forever. I don't know what to live. What's dead? It's dead as earth. Let me, a looking glass. If that her breath should miss the stained stone, why then she lives. Cordelia. Cordelia, stay him at the home.
My good master.
Bring thee away.
Tis noble Kent, your friend.
You are welcome, Edmund.
Your eldest daughters have outdone themselves, and desperately are dead.
Aye, so I think.
Your lords and noble friends, know our intent. What comfort to this great decay may come shall be applied. For us, we will resign during the life of this old majesty to him our absolute power.
And my poor fool is hanged. No, no life. Why should a dog, a horse, a rat have life and thou no breath at all? I'll come no more. Never. Never, never. Never. Bring me the end of this. Do you see this? Look on her. Look on them. Look there.
He faints! My lord! My lord!
That's not his ghost! Oh, let him pass. He hates him much, then put him upon the back of this tough world, stretch him out longer.
He is gone indeed.
Friends of my soul, you twain rule in this realm, and the Goad state sustain. Bear them from hence. Our present business is general woe.
I have a journey, sir, shortly to go. My master calls me. I must not say no.
It's over. How's it feel?
Huh?
It's over. How's it feel?
It's surreal that it's over, because it's like, I know, because tomorrow I don't have rehearsal.
Mm-hmm.
What?
It's like...
And after I would do something, I would hit my last moment and I'd be like, I don't get to do that again. And that really stinks.